The Fullbring arc, or the Last Agent arc, may be the most controversial arc of the anime and manga. After the heights of such a huge battle with one of the main, and possibly one of, the best villains in anime, being Aizen, we had come off this huge climax of an invested plotline, and the expectation in and of itself was scarce to say the least. Mainly because no one knew where the story would be heading, and people were left on such a high feeling. So when Kubo toned down the stakes to proceed the story, I can understand why fans felt disappointed, especially getting blueballed with Mugetsu. It was one of the main reasons why people would say the anime was cancelled. After all, it did do badly as far as ratings and manga sales go. Unless there happened to be a context to economic change and how media was in fact consumed, such as streaming services or digital manga or digital sales. However, over the past few years, we now know that it wasn't cancelled. Who would have thought? Who would have thought? But that, in and of itself, isn't important for today's video. No, we're here to find out why the Fullbring arc may actually be just the most underrated arc in Bleach, despite being one of the least flashiest fight-wise until the climax itself. So if you want to hear more about Bleach or perhaps other anime in general, make sure to subscribe to the channel, like and comment about why I'm wrong or the anime you want to talk about for future videos. Before I get into the little facts about the arc and delve deeper, it's only right that we talk about the perspective of the manga reader or the anime watcher going into this, as it is of course the first impressions that stick around and spread the longest. Ichigo lost his powers, having just defeated Aizen and saving the day several months prior, which he did willingly and would repeat no matter how many times he would need to. Then, of course, a man comes along and extends his hand to help him. Ginjo Kujo is a very strongly written character with his diverse emotions, strong conviction, and cunning that surpassed only the greatest minds of the Soul Society, or so he would lead you to believe. Ginjo appeared when Ichigo needed it the most, but the Fullbringers is a group that thankfully, if you were to compare it from the cast of the prior arcs, the Fullbring arc is one of the smallest for the majority of it, which makes it quite easy to keep up with its roster. The rest of our new cast is of course Ginjo Kujo's partner in crime, being Tsukushima, the man who would serve to be the blood that makes the first substitute Soul Reaper's plan feasible. And while we're talking about Tsukushima, there is of course Mo, the second luckiest man in Bleach. As for the main Fullbringers, you have the emotionally driven and cool Jackie, the calm, reserved clock guy being Giriko, the eccentric gamer with a knack for business, Yukio, and finally, the Lolita Soul Queen of all things cute, Ruruka. Alongside Ginjo, these are the four that will make up the main Fullbring roster, and while some of these are more rounded than others, they are genuinely solid characters that stand equal to Ginjo. Now, the main course is pretty simple. Ginjo gives Ichigo a new lease on life and the ability to regain his power, and with the help of the Fullbringers, Ichigo commits to it. After all, he can't sense anything wrong with them, even when he gains some degree of power, yet the foe Tsukushima seems to be too much, and this is reinforced by Ginjo. Of course, Ichigo is backed into a corner very quickly after gaining strength and witnessing the horror of Tsukushima, something he is powerless to stop. His only chance to defeat and perhaps even kill, with his conviction, he reaches his literal wit's end. After clawing back his chances to protect the ones he loved and maybe even touch upon the subject of his mother again, it is robbed from him, this time by the man he put complete trust into and would very likely have considered to be a friend. At this point, Ichigo, as a 17-year-old boy, breaks down into tears as the sky weeps with rain. But our protagonist isn't one to take things lying down, demanding his powers back, as he is then stabbed from behind, but initially mistaking it to be an attack until he sees a familiar face, Rukia. And at this point, Ichigo has finally returned. Which I feel is very fitting, as the light novel after the Fullbring arc, as the chapter 1 follows the same name, the death, being Rukia, saves the strawberry, being Ichigo, or is chapter 1's title, Death and the Strawberry. The sky opens up and familiar faces appear, Kenpachi and Yachiru, captain and lieutenant of the 11th division, Ikkaku and Renji, members of squad 11 and squad 6 respectively, and Toshiro and Byakuya, captains of squad 10 and 6. All these Soul Reaper characters have some kind of relationship with Ichigo and is relevant for why later on. Not forgetting of course Rukia, who is the one that began it all. It has finally come full circle. Now getting past the implications of the character showing up for Ichigo, but just the scene in and of itself is incredible. Going from Ichigo at his lowest moment to his confusion and then understanding after seeing Rukia, but then bam, it pans up, the music, the lighting, the animation, it is all done perfectly. The hype you feel from seeing those doors open and seeing figures within the first time is literally exhilarating. Then, the long-awaited badass fights that Bleach is loved for arrived with the rest of the cast, and in full swing, gives you exactly what you want from the battle. From those who dare with the techniques and tenacity with Byakuya, to the decimation and brutality brought with Kenpachi and his well-loved demeanor, to the confrontation of the luckiest man in their respective factions, Ikkaku Madarame. Of course, the finale, a fight between Ichigo and Ginjo, a confrontation brewing since before they had even met. A battle against, well, humans. So what makes all this special? Well, given the brief rundown and in and of itself being very quick and easy to understand, it isn't amazing to any degree at first glance if you're speaking strictly story-wise and if we ignore on how well executed it is. We can look at the context and can see the deeper meaning, as we all know Kubo likes putting in layers to his story. One of such layers, for example, is Kubo really wanted to alienate his audience by making them feel uncomfortable, with a bigger impact for the viewer's emotion for when the uncomfortability had been lifted. From the interview with Shonen Jump, issue 51 for the Jump 53rd Leisure Newcomer Mangaka Awards, when asked from the interviewer, "Please tell us more about the change of designs from Ichigo's Fullbring outfit to his new appearance when he got his powers back as a Shinigami." He stated, "Ichigo's Fullbring outfit was based from the image of Takatsu heroes that little kids would find it as cool. My goal when designing the Fullbring outfit was to give the longtime Bleach readers in certain age groups to feel uneasy and worried. So when the relieved impact when Ichigo got back his Shihakusho, his Shinigami robes, can be felt more immensely. At the same time, I designed those with those in mind. I definitely felt there was a lot of sweating from the audience to the point of an even make or break in loyalty for quote unquote toughing it through the arc itself. Though a gamble, it had the biggest payoff to the audience's relief. Though I will say, fun fact as well, in the light novel The Death Saves the Strawberry, a novel that was released in September 2012, unfortunately releasing after the anime's temporary closure, it's a novel in and of itself that is surrounding the concept of Rukia trying to regain Ichigo's powers back during the 17 months of Ichigo's normal life, as you could say.
Now, what I'm about to tell you is very evident within the Fullbringer arc. Anime or manga, it conveys the same way. This part of the novel really hits into Ichigo's development and his emotion. It's driving more onto the outside perspective rather than living in Ichigo's perspective. The problem with living in Ichigo's perspective is that we aren't told much other than visual representation. Even though we knew he wasn't happy with his new, safe, and normal lifestyle, there were core aspects we never took into consideration because, as the audience, we were too focused on when will Ichigo get his powers back, more than what is our character going through mentally. What is the author, Kubo, trying to convey and why? Ichigo has always fought in order to protect something. That is his actions philosophy, as well as his foundation stone. If it's a dispute between two people without any special powers, I'm sure Ichigo doesn't fall behind in that respect. I think there are lots of people he can protect in that respect too. In practice, Ichigo has been helping and saving a lot of people, even after he lost his powers. Like saving a schoolboy who was targeted by a boy who looked like a scoundrel, catching a purse snatcher, saving an aged person from almost getting run over by a car. When he saved the girl who had slipped from the veranda, fell, and whom he had caught in the nick of time, you know, essentially saving her life in that respect, he was sent a letter of appreciation from the police. However, he has now come to know the existence of people he can't save with just the power of a human being. For Ichigo right now, it was no longer possible to see them or touch them. Even so, they still continue to exist and continue to be thrown into dangers. He never knew if a hollow was actually trying to devour a soul in the corner of the street he just passed by without a thought. While knowing that, he still can't do anything. For Ichigo, whose will to protect is stronger than anyone else's, it must be an unbearable pain. The ironic thing is this was very subtly placed. If you were to reread the Fullbringer arc right now, you would reread it in a whole new light because you read it looking for something else rather than the shonen sword clashing perspective you came off of the Aizen finale. That's what Kubo wanted.
Kubo wanted a reboot. He wanted to show his audience Ichigo's maturity since chapter 1 by rebooting the series itself. In a Shonen Jump interview, Kubo said, "I was trying to reboot and recreate what I had done with Bleach up until now. In Bleach Chapter 1, Ichigo gained the power of a Soul Reaper, but now that he has lost that power, Ichigo must get it back. It's like starting all over. The Lost Agent arc is important because it leads into future chapters. But enough about perspective, and back onto what we can see outright with our own eyes. The loss of his powers, though for a just cause, resulted in him losing the ability to protect what matters, which were only possible with his Soul Reaper ability. After all, we know his goals in life remained unchanged, and he made sure to keep up his grades for employment, even though those were not his only priority. The notorious desire or goal to protect his loved ones was taken from him. Iryu, Chad, and Orihime leaving class in a hurry to take care of Hollows he once fought. If they were injured, there was nothing he could do. He was powerless. But we know this isn't his only goal. He had others, and for the most important of which was only granted to him due to possessing these Soul Reaper abilities, finding out what happened to his mother. This goal may not have been outright said at any point, but only subconsciously, but only with this does it make sense for Ichigo to be the way that he is. A 17-year-old boy who was robbed of something most immediate and most important thing to him. If he wasn't depressed, it would have been strange. The Soul Reaper shown represented that the bonds he had formed were in fact real, and that he was not forgotten. The Soul Society that was locked in its traditions actively gave back his strength. They came to his rescue this time round. I would say this alongside the reaffirmation of his goals is why Ichigo is so composed and cool from this point onwards. He found himself once more, and the Soul Society supporting him would be something that gave him both strength and which would also be protecting him. He was accepted by them after having fought them, and fought them all this time for the recognition alone would be something which gives him the confidence and trust, which will be very relevant to his decision later on against Ginjo. Of course, there was more than just this in the arc as well. The relationship, for example, between Ruruka, Ichigo, and Orihime is put front and center, which Ruruka from the start was interested in Ichigo, but through her interactions with both of them, she understood that she didn't belong. That Ichigo and Orihime were perhaps not strong enough to let each other know that they both loved each other, which calls back to why the final scene of her leaping or leaving is so important. She herself, Ruruka, who took everything she liked, gave up on something she loved. From all things cute to males she had interest in. Ichigo was her first realization that for once, she couldn't have something. And that was pivotal for her character development. And the highlight? Ichigo killed his second person. Up until this point, you could argue that Ichigo only killed Okiura, and we know he didn't want to. In fact, if he were not for impressing matters, the fact that he killed him would have probably been more of an effect. Ichigo killing Ginjo is an extremely important moment. After all, he hasn't really killed anyone before just, well, Hollows. This, with the intent of burying Ginjo, showcased him truly maturing. Everything was finally back to normal. These are the reasons I think the arc is underrated, as it shows so much needed and desired growth as a character, and without this arc, the next would not have had the same impact. After all, if Ichigo did not gain a better control of his spiritual pressure through his training with Ginjo, for example, Ginjo slashing Ichigo's eyes so he wasn't reliant on them to quote-unquote see spiritual energy, or consolidated or reaffirmed himself as a person, or still lacked the intent to show the ability to kill, he would not have been prepared for the threat that was lying in the shadows. Ironically. This was a shonen battle manga's arc, and while it was marred by filler in the anime, it truly stands as an incredible arc in my opinion, and I hope looking at things this way you can agree as well. But with that being said, I want to thank Tekken for joining me along on this video. Please go check him out. With that being said, please like, comment, and subscribe if you want to see more videos like this. And of course, I'm going to catch you guys later. You guys, of course, have this fine day. I've been Hansen, and as always, people, peace out.